Think we can go. So thank you for attending my session. I'm impressed to have Kevin and Mitri in the room, so I will try to be my best. I'm going to speak about Jakarta EE, a well-known topic here at EclipseCon, and I propose to do it with a specific angle for following a user perspective. Why a user perspective? When Oracle announced its intention to open source Jakarta EE, I observed a lot of enthusiasm in the community. My personal reaction was more nuanced. On the one hand, I was not happy with the lack of progress of the platform. Clearly, a change was needed. But on the other hand, I must admit that I was a bit skeptical about the capacity to define and implement an open source governance model, because I think that governance is key for a standard platform. So from then on, I've tried to be an active observer, sharing my opinions by writing articles, doing presentation talks like today, and getting feedbacks. So, a few words about me. I am Jean-François James. I work at Worldline, an Atos Origin company, an Atos company. I have more than 30 years of experience in the IT. So, what do we do at Worldline? We build and run digital platforms on behalf of our customers. Our core domain is payment, and we have expanded our capacity to process secured electronic transactions to other domains such as health, transport, e-government. And maybe the most stable part of my career has been Java. I've spent more than 20 years with it. I started with Java 1.1 a long time ago. I've used Resin, Tomcat, OpenAGB, Tommy, JBoss, on all kinds of platform of projects. So this is the agenda of my talk. We will start with a retrospective. Knowing the past is essential to look to the future. We will analyze the changes that have led to so-called cloud native applications. I will speak more specifically about Java EE 8, the very last release of the Java EE platform and the baseline of Jakarta EE. I will explain what I mean by the turbulent zone, which happened last year. And of course, we will see the challenges for the future. So, this is my vision of the evolution of the Java EE platform until Java EE 7. I will speak more specifically about Java EE 8 later. So, a long time ago, it started with the J2E times, the ancient times, let's say the prehistoric times. The intention was good, but the execution was not, because the specifications were done in a spec-first approach, starting from a blank page, in isolation from the developer, and that progressively led to over-complexity. In 2003, with J2E E1.4, we reached what the Gartner called the trough of disillusionment. You know, the bottom on the hype cycle, on the Gartner hype cycle. In response to that frustration, Rod Johnson wrote a book proposing an alternative, a pragmatic way to develop Java enterprise application. And that book had a huge impact on the community. First, it led to the creation of the Spring Framework, and it also invited people working on the specifications to reconsider their way of working. And they decided to switch to a code-first approach to be more pragmatic. And for the first time, with Java EE 5, ease of development was really taken into consideration. So, another major milestone has been achieved with JBoss Sim, a framework developed by Gavin King, the founder of Hibernate, which introduced CDI, context and dependency injection. CDI is a generic injection mechanism acting as a glue between the specifications and also to integrate external technologies. And Java EE 7 was essentially a continuity with additional features related to batch processing, JSON processing, WebSocket support, and concurrency to support asynchronous programming. And by the way, Java EE7 was a very good, a very mature release. So from a strategic standpoint, Java EE from 5 to 7 was a good trade-off between innovation and standardization. It aimed to be the place to standardize innovations, which, by the way, was true. GPA, for instance, is essentially a standardization of Hibernate. CDI is derived from JBoss-SIM. JBatch has been highly influenced by Spring Batch. And in particular, Java EE was a good fit for long-term projects, which is typically the case in payment, where we need capitalization on the technical stack, backward compatibility, and strong patch management, in particular, security patch management to face PCI, payment card industry regulations. So maybe Java EE was not very innovative, but it was a really reasonable choice for many enterprise projects. After Java EE 7, the pace of change began to accelerate, driven by a continuous flow of innovation. It started many years ago with Amazon, popularizing the concept of cloud platforms, DevOps, calling for better cooperation between dev and ops, with good practices such as continuous deployment, infrastructure as code, NoSQL and polyglot persistences, with solutions such as Cassandra and MongoDB, challenging traditional SQL databases, microservices architectures, embodied by Netflix and formalized by the 12 factors, the container revolution, of course, with Docker and Kubernetes, and the comeback of reactive programming to achieve better stability and scalability of applications on cloud platform, on cloud platforms. And in a few years, all this change proved to be very consistent together and led to what we call cloud-native applications, typically made of self-runnable distributed services with built-in resiliency, built-in health check, monitoring, packaged and deployed in containers on cloud platforms, making the most of DevOps good practices. That doesn't mean that there is no longer room for the model on the left, but clearly the trend is on the right, and cloud-native applications have become mainstream even for traditional organizations. And what happened to that good old Java EE platform in the meantime? Well, nothing during 2 years. And this proved to be very damaging for the platform because many developers decided to move away from it. Things restarted in 2016 with two initiatives. In response to the lack of progress, an active group, the Java EE Guardians, was set up by Reza Rehman in order to restart the specification. So they organized surveys, petitioned, made noise, trying to influence Oracle. At the same time, a group of Java EE vendors started the MicroProfile initiative to define an open specification for Java microservices. And the same year, at Java One, Oracle shared a new and ambitious roadmap. The objective was to renew the platform in 2 years. So the community was enthusiastic again. Things were back on track. And 1 year after, Java EE 8 was there, with Glassfish 5, its reference implementation. So what is Java EE 8? Basically, it is an alignment to Java SE 8. As a reminder, Java SE 8 has been released in 2014, 1 year after Java EE 7. So it was necessary to take into account new types, such as optional, streams, completable feature. Java EE 8 also includes two new specifications, security, which propose a simplified approach for authentication and authorization mechanism, and JSONB, which propose a standard API to bind Java classes and JSON structures. And there were very interesting updates to existing specs, such as Servlet 4.0, CDIs 2.0, and so on. So basically, Java EE 8 was a very good restart of the platform, but nothing revolutionary and nothing really cloud native. And Java E8 was clearly presented by Oracle, if we go back to the roadmap, as an intermediate step, the target being defined as Java E9. The problem is that Java E9, as you may know, will never exist. And Java E8 has been released amid what I call a turbulent zone. So what happened? After 20 years of stability, everything changed in summer 2017. Early August, Oracle announced its intention to stop the development of Java E and to open source it. Mid-August. Early September, Oracle announced a new and very disruptive release cadence for Java SE, Java Standard Edition, with two feature releases per year and one long-term support every 3 years. So this is challenging for the whole Java ecosystem. Mid-September, the Eclipse Foundation was chosen to host the future of Java E. Java SE 9 and Java E 8 were delivered at the same time, and end of September, the top-level Eclipse Enterprise for Java project was created to host the future of Java E. So everything changed in 43 days, and that left us, the end user of the technology, in a state of interrogation. What's going on? Where are we going? So from now on, I propose to share some concerns, some issues, and some expectations I have in mind for the future of the Jakarta E platform. So my first concern was about the replacement of the JCP, the Java Community Process. So far, the JCP was the sole authority able to define Java standards. And the Eclipse Foundation is not a standard body. It is an open source organization. It is able to define open specifications, but only their adoption by the industry can turn them into standard. So, what will make an open specification under the auspice of Eclipse better than any existing solution? Who will be interested in using it? Who will be interested in contributing to it? These are not easy questions, and there is not a single answer, but there are some positive indicators. First, let's see what is exactly the Eclipse Foundation. I must admit that until Jakarta EE, my understanding of Eclipse was limited to the IDE, like many people in the IT, I think. But in reality, Eclipse is host to about 350 projects spread across 7 technical tracks, and it is strongly supported, backed, and sponsored by the industry. One important aspect, its core value is vendor neutrality. So to better appreciate the diversity of Eclipse projects, let's focus on 4 of them. EE4G, Eclipse Enterprise for Java, you already know it. It is the top-level project towards the future of Java E. It is an umbrella for about 39 projects. So many lines of codes have been transferred here. MicroProfile, the initiative started in 2016 has become an Eclipse project. OpenG9, it's in fact IBM JVM technology. It is OpenJDK compliant. It is an alternative to the hotspot, and it delivers very good performance in terms of startup and memory footprints, two attributes of high importance on cloud platforms. Vertix is a well-known toolkit to develop reactive applications. It is led by Red Hat, and GNOSQL is a framework to facilitate NoSQL integration. So, through these 5 examples, we have a lot of diversity. We have 2 projects related to open specifications. We have 3 final products. Out of them, 2 are led but not fully controlled by commercial company. So clearly, Eclipse is a good place to define open specifications ready to be adopted by the industry. So this is a good point. My second concern is about governance. During 20 years, the JCP, the Java Community Process, managed by Oracle, the owner of the technology, has done a very great job in that matter. Each specification was managed in the form of a GSR, Java Specification Request, with a dedicated expert group, a specification leader, three well-defined deliverables, a documentation, a reference implementation, a technology compatibility kit, and following a well-defined lifecycle from initiation to final release. So this model has enabled the platform to last 20 years, but it has not been able to cope with recent pace of change. So what do we need today? We still need strong governance, but strong is not enough. We also need speed. To facilitate the integration of innovations and new technology at the right pace. So what is the model, the new model proposed by the Eclipse Foundation? And a new entity, the Jakarta E-Working Group, will be responsible of the governance, managing the brand name, the steering committee, and the specification process. Specifications and implementations will be run as standard open source projects. There will be no expert group, no specification leader, and no exclusive ownership of the IP. As a reminder, with the GCP, the IP, the intellectual property of a specification, was the exclusive ownership of the specification leader. So this is no more true. There will be no reference implementation, but there will be at least one compatible open source implementation will be needed to validate a specification. Access to the TCK will be free with a self-certification mechanism. This is also a big change because previously accessing the TCK was expensive and subject to legal constraints, complex legal constraints, and it took months, not to say years, to get certified implementations. So this process is supposed to be more agile. And for me, it remains a challenge. Clearly, the proper execution of this process will be key for the future of the platform. And as we say, devil is in the details. So clearly, it is a challenge. My third concern was about turning Jakarta EE into a cloud-native platform. As mentioned, Java EE 8, the baseline, is not at the state of the art regarding cloud-native applications. But what does it mean to be a good software cloud citizen? It requires several characteristics that I have defined three categories. At the orchestration level, where Kubernetes is king, we need service registry and discovery, traffic management, including routing and load balancing. At the runtime level, regarding the JVM and the application server, we need fast startup and low footprint. And fortunately, the Java ecosystem is very active regarding that, with projects such as OpenG9, GraalVM, and also lightweight and modular application server such as OpenLiberty. So clearly, we are in the right direction regarding the runtime. MicroProfile brings a set of additional characteristics for distributed architectures, including external configuration, built-in monitoring health check. We have many distributed services. We need absolutely to know how each of them is, what is its status, distributed tracing, self-documented APIs, and security between services. So let's have a look at MicroProfile. So the initiative started in 2016 with a minimalist release just based on three Java EE specifications. I must admit that I was very skeptical at that time. But they have managed to deliver six releases, and there are five implementations. There are five available implementations. Among them, OpenLiberty, Thorntail, more recently, Helidon, and Payara, and Tommy Tribe, and Tommy, of course. And MicroProfile is very interesting regarding Jakarta-E for two reasons. It is both a demonstrator and an incubator. It is a demonstrator because it has demonstrated how an open specification can work under the auspice of Eclipse. And it is a demonstrator because by an incubator because by construction, Jakarta-E is Java-E compliant, and all its features are ready to be injected into Jakarta-E. So, roughly speaking, turning Jakarta-EE in a true cloud-native platform, will consist in injecting MicroProfile features in it. To terminate my talk, I want to share a personal wish list for the coming year. I've made a distinction in four areas. I've defined four areas: platform improvements, modernization, governance, dev attention, and adoption. Regarding platform improvement, I think it is time to converge EJB and CDI. There are many overlapping and ambiguities between them, and it's very difficult for newcomers to understand why such a difference. We also need modular APIs and implementation that we can use at will, use and compose at will without dependency on the whole platform. In terms of modernization, beyond microservices, we need NoSQL. It seems that JNoSQL has been chosen as a foundation of a new specification in that matter. This is a good news. I think that also it is important to integrate GraphQL as app. GraphQL is an alternative, a complementary to RESTful API. It's very interesting. I would like to see something like Delta Spike data included in the platform to simplify GPA usage. In terms of governance, I insist on one aspect: the proper execution of the specification process. Clearly, it will be key for next year. I think that for the moment, MicroProfile and Jakarta-EE must be separated projects because they follow their own purpose and they don't have the same life cycle. So, for next year, I think that keeping them separate is meaningful. I would like Jakarta-EE to be compliant with Java SE long-term support. I think that Jakarta-EE is for production. And in particular, it should remain compatible with Java SE 8, which will remain mainstream for a while, clearly, and also with the new long-term support based on Java SE 11. And we need high consistency and loose coupling with cloud platforms, in particular Kubernetes, Docker, Istio. I mean, no direct technical dependencies from Jakarta-EE to cloud platforms. I also think that a significant effort must be done to gain developers' attention and adoption. Because clearly the focus of developers is now on cloud platforms and in particular mastering Kubernetes and Docker. And there is little room for a new specification challenging well-established software stack such as Node.js and Spring Cloud. So we need to evangelize. We need to evangelize here at big event, but we need to evangelize locally, in our companies, in our cities, in JUG, in Meetup, and so on. I've done it several times, and believe me, it's not easy. It's a challenge to speak about Jakarta-EE and MicroProfile. Of course, we need easy and intuitive adoption with project starters, things like Spring Initializer or GHipster. Personally, I would be very happy to see GHipster with a backend based on MicroProfile and Jakarta E. We need ease of testing. Clearly, this is a domain where Java E doesn't shine. And I've seen important projects in my companies deciding to move away from Java E just because of that. We need lightweight, I would even say invisible application servers. And we are in the right direction, I think. And of course, we need seamless integration with Kubernetes and Docker, because this is where developers' attention is today. So we need to play on the same playground as developers. So as a conclusion, Jakarta Java E is ended, but it has a promising future with Java E. MicroProfile has paved the way, being both an incubator and a demonstrator. The Eclipse Foundation is a place to be to define open specifications ready to be adopted by the industry. But next year will be decisive, with two main challenges. Once again, the proper execution of the specification process. I'm sorry to insist on that, but I think it will be key. And another very important challenge will be getting developers' attention and adoption. So as users, we can be part of the story, of course. And that being said, I think that, okay, maybe we are ready for another 20 years. So thank you. I am on time or not?